Hey there, welcome to part three of our People Called Methodist Lessons, where we're talking all about the history of the Methodist Church, the theology of the Methodist Church, which you've done the last 2 weeks. If you haven't done that, feel free to check those videos out. And today we're going to be talking about the polity and governance and structure of the Methodist Church and sort of how all that operates. I was telling somebody this past week that to me, I think at just surface level, this is probably the least interesting of all of the lessons that we have. But if you've been around the Methodist Church at all, some of these terms might be familiar to you, but be pretty gray in terms of what they actually mean. And so that might be helpful to some of us to really just kind of see how all of this fits together. Probably the most interesting part of all this that I can think of would just be, oh, okay, so that's how that works. And this is what that means when we talk about that. And really, this is what's accomplished when that's happening. And so hopefully that can be something that can interest you throughout the course of this. And the truth is that as methodical as we are in our discipleship, which is where we get the name Methodist from, we're not as methodical in our theology, even though, if you remember from last time, we have foundational theological doctrines, but a big enough tent that there's various forms and ways of thinking amongst all at all levels of the Methodist Church. We're methodical in our structure. We are methodical in our governance, perhaps above all else. And much of John Wesley, the founder of Methodism's success, came at this organizational level, that most effectively, as an administrator and an organizer of all of this ministry, is how we ended up being where we are today, and perhaps the reason why we really know the name John Wesley beyond the theology is because we owe our existence to this type of organizational structure. And ultimately, the way the United Methodist Church governs itself is through what we call conferences. Everything at every level is called conferences. And those conferences do conference, so they do gather. But even when we refer to them as a whole, we still refer to them as conferences, even when they aren't physically conferencing or physically gathered together. There are conferences at the global, at the regional, and at the local level. And so we'll start at the local level first and then get bigger. And then that way, once we get to the bigger parts, you'll know what those bigger parts are made up of. Our church here at Centralia UMC is what's called a charge conference. A charge conference. Our church happens to be a charge conference in and of itself, but there are other churches that are. There are multiple churches within a single charge. And so a lot of times if you hear a pastor who's serving multiple churches at the same time, those churches are together in the same charge. It just so happens to be that for us, our church is a single charge. So for us, our board is our governing body for our church that does the day in and day out, the week in and week out organization and structure of our church, to set the vision for our church, to do the work of establishing budgets and things of that nature happen at this level. But the charge conference, the charge annual meeting, the officers are where the officers of our church are elected, where the budgets are officially approved. That's where if property is bought or sold, that's where that becomes formally approved. The approval of membership gains, the approval of membership losses happens at this meeting. And so much more. If there's someone that's been identified as a candidate for ministry, they are officially nominated here. And I'll talk about what sort of all that means in a minute. But all this happens within conjunction with our district. And we'll talk about what district is next. Because ultimately, the question though is who makes up this charge? The people are the ones who make up this charge. The members of our board, the officers of our church that are elected are representing the church as a whole. At a charge conference, only board members have a vote. So only board members that go to charge conference have a vote to approve all of that stuff. But there are times when a church conference might be called that's made up of the same group. It's all about our local church. But at a church conference, typically bigger things would be looked at here to call a church conference where all members of that church would have a vote. There are various things that would happen that would require that, but that's the difference between a charge conference and a church conference. But at either one, anyone is welcome to come, but at a charge conference, only board members have a vote, and at a church conference, all members have a vote. Now, the other thing to think about with the charge conference is that only a district superintendent can supervise that gathering. It cannot happen without the district superintendent or without the district superintendent's sort of written approval of someone else holding the meeting. But the vast, vast majority of the time, our district superintendent or a district superintendent is going to supervise and then preside over a charge conference, which brings us to the examination of our district. So our district in the state of Missouri, we have 5 different districts. They're on the screen as you can see them, and they're broken up geographically. So essentially this is looking at how are we going to keep track of, oversee, supervise what's happening at all of these churches across the state of Missouri. Well, we're going to break it up into geographical areas of our state that we call districts. And the districts are made up of all of the charges within that geographical area. You can kind of think of this similar to our US government, where you have sort of a local city or town governance, and then you have a county governance, and then you have sort of your state governance, and on and on and on, right? It's similar within the Methodist Church. And each district is led by a district superintendent. The district superintendent oversees and is responsible for the pastors within the district, the churches within that district, making sure that business is happening, but also looking at the context of that district and leading them in the direction that they need to go to ensure that they are doing what they need to be doing to pursue the mission of making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And so oversight comes from that area. In this image, if you see the little pins, those are the locations of the district offices in each one of the districts. But the district superintendents are responsible for all of the churches in that area. Most of them, if not all of them, have triple digit number of churches that they are looking at within their district. It's a lot to oversee, but much more bite-sized and broken down into districts than if we were to look at it as just the state or just the region. And the district themselves also has their own conference. You have district conferencing because the district has its own budget, its own board, and its own committees that are filled with both clergy and laity that are overseeing the work of the district, that are doing the same thing that our leadership board is doing for us and our charge conference is doing for us at the local level. They're just doing the same thing at the district level. Now, the 5 districts make up what we call our annual conference. For Missouri in the United Methodist Church, the Missouri annual conference is just the state of Missouri. It just happens to be that way. There are some churches that are made up of multiple states, and there are some states that are made up of multiple conferences, and there are some conferences that are made up of multiple states. I know that's confusing to say, but just trust me, and here in a second you'll see an example of what I'm talking about. But for example, the Missouri Conference used to be made up of 2 different conferences. We used to have an East and a West Missouri, but now we've merged just into one conference. But all of the churches make up the annual conference. All of the individual charges are who makes up the annual conference. But the annual conference does gather. Many of you know in the United Methodist Church in Missouri, our conferencing happens at the beginning of June. And so you'll see a lot of pastors out of the pulpit that week conducting the business of the entire conference at that point. What happens at the annual conference is that appointments are fixed by the bishop. So wherever the pastors are being appointed to within the state, that's fixed at annual conference. They're officially placed at their churches each year at annual conference. And so as a pastor, as an elder, my membership belongs to the United Methodist Church, belongs more specifically to the Missouri Annual Conference of the United Methodist Church, not to local churches. So I will never hold membership of a local church because I'm an elder, a member of the Missouri Conference. And so that means that I'm appointed, I am allowing myself to be at the whims of what's necessary for the leadership of the annual conference to put not just me, but all of the elders in Missouri at the churches that best fit the missional needs of the church at any given year. And so those appointments only happen 1 year at a time. You may serve a church for 20 years, 30 years, but the appointments are still 1 year at a time. It would just mean that you serve for 30 consecutive appointments or 20 consecutive appointments. So you can serve theoretically for any number of years, but just appointed 1 year at a time. And so as I mentioned a little bit before, we call this the itinerant system, which means that me and my family have committed to the mission of the Missouri Annual Conference. And so I'm at their disposal to be moved to any place within the conference, so within the state of Missouri, that's deemed appropriate for the mission. At annual conference, we also approve the budget for the annual conference. We approve the ordination of ordinands. We approve candidates for ministry, which is people who seek ordination in some capacity. We hear reports in more business like that. Recently, we've been dealing with things like disaffiliations of people who are leaving the United Methodist Church, and so things like that would be approved. Church closures, church additions, things of that nature all happen at the annual conference. Now, going regionally, we have what are called jurisdictional conferences. Our annual conference is part of a jurisdictional conference, which is, again, it's regional. You can see that on the map. We work together with other conferences. We have delegates from our annual conference that go to jurisdictional conference, and the number of delegates is based on the population. I think for both jurisdictional and general conference, we have 12 total, 6 clergy and 6 lay that go to those. I could be wrong about jurisdictional conference of how many we have. Jurisdictional conference meets once every 4 years unless a necessary additional gathering is called. But the main duty of jurisdictional conference is the election and appointment of bishops. Bishops are just elders who have run for election, but a bishop is the leader of any given annual conference. Every annual conference has a bishop that presides over the annual conference as their leader. And you have to be an elder to become a bishop. There is no higher ranking per se than an elder within our church. It just so happens that an elder has run to become bishop and has been elected bishop by the jurisdictional conference. And bishops serve 2 4-year terms, but they can serve a third if the annual conference that they serve in requests for them to serve a third. And there are a various number of bishops that are needed at any given time. It depends on retirement and election and changes within conferences and on and on and on. But bishops are appointed by the jurisdictional conference to the area of need. So when you run for election as bishop, you don't run for election as a bishop within a certain conference. You run for bishop, and then just like the itinerant pastors who work toward ordination, and then they're appointed by the conference, bishops are also appointed. And so for Missouri right now in 2023, it just so happens that our bishop has come out of our own annual conference, which is not at all common. We're blessed by it, but it's not at all common that happens. So that's the jurisdictional conference, that's regional. And then you have the general conference, which is the highest level of church governance that we have. It is the highest legislative body of the United Methodist Church. The General Conference is the only body in the United Methodist Church that can speak for the church and revise our doctrine. Remember, except for the Articles of Religion. Any group or person at this General Conference where people gather, delegates gather from every annual conference all around the globe into one place. Any individual person can submit a petition for discussion, but that doesn't necessarily mean that petition is actually going to be discussed. The ones that tend to be handled are ones that are brought by annual conferences, and especially if there are multiple annual conferences that are wanting to discuss the same thing. Those tend to be the ones that reach the floor most often. Now, this, again, is a global conference. We have churches, I believe, in every hemisphere, but not in necessarily in every single country. But it is a global conference of the United Methodists from around the world. where representatives from each annual conference are sent. For us, I mentioned this a minute ago, we have 12 total representatives, 6 clergy and 6 lay, that are elected the year before at annual conference to go serve at general conference. And in the year 2023 right now, the next general conference that we have is in the spring, this coming spring of 2024. And they vote on all sorts of different types of legislation there. Most legislation requires majority vote from these delegates, but a change of discipline requires 2/3. And the change of discipline then is also moved to the annual conferences to each vote, and that requires a 2/3 vote from the annual conference as well for approval, similar to an amendment for us in the U.S. For Congress. Our apportionments are also approved at this. The budgets are approved at General Conference. And our apportionments are what we kind of look at as our church taxes. And this seems very boring, but to be a part of this connectional system, it's part of what's necessary to make that happen. And so it seems boring, but there's so much amazing ministry that happens because of that. And you can see the benefit of being part of this system. And I liken it to this, that we don't like paying our taxes, but when the road starts to get run down in front of our house or the street that we use all the time, we get really, really irritated about it, don't it? So somebody's got to take care of that, and that's our tax money that helps take care of that, right? And it's similar to our apportionments. But our apportionments also go to do a lot of amazing things. They go to amazing ministry that feeds people, that houses people, that powers houses, that provides scholarships, social justice work. It helps plant churches, it helps grow churches, it helps revitalize churches, and even more. And so our apportionments are vital to the health of this global denomination that we believe in. And the reason that we buy into this connectional system is because this is what the church is supposed to be. Not individual units of people, but a collective universal church from around the world of all cultures, of all races, that are worshiping the same God. And also at General Conference, that's where the contents of our book of worship are worked on. The contents of our hymnal are voted on. Things of that nature also tend to happen at General Conference. And the bishops from all the conferences around the globe preside over the sessions, but do not have a vote in and of themselves. Only elected members of the General Conference have a vote. They simply preside over the meetings. So that's the structure of our church. And so I thought next we kind of take a brief minute to talk about how exactly does one become a pastor and what does that look like within our church? Where does the authority come from? And what does it take for one to become a leader in that capacity within this structure? So to enter into ordained ministry, one must first become a candidate for ministry. They're identified by their local church or their home church as someone with gifts for ministry and a desire to pursue ministry at the level of ordination or begin to pursue ordination. And so they have to seek confirmation of this call by the district, if you remember that. There's a district committee that hears their call, that reads their papers, that asks them questions about their call, and then will approve them to become a candidate within the conference. Once you're identified as a candidate within the conference, you have an annual interview that is what's called continuation. As you are doing your education or moving down whatever path it is that you're moving down, they're just checking in with you to make sure that your call is still strong, that you're developing in ministry, that you're developing gifts, and that you're learning. Oftentimes when somebody goes into candidacy, they begin seminary. So they'll go through a seminary education during their candidacy. And once they get about halfway through, not everybody does this, but once you get halfway through, you can move into the level of commissioning, which means that you are a provisional elder or a provisional deacon. We'll talk about the difference of that in a second. So you are provisionally ordained, essentially, when you're commissioned. And we liken this to the medical field or to the psychological field where you have residency for a couple years, and it's the same for ordination. Your commissioning is a residency period of 2 years where you are heavily watched by your district, heavily watched by your conference. They're looking for the theology that you've learned to be able to be applied in an actual church and ministry setting. And so you go through commissioning for 2 years, And once that becomes approved, there's more paperwork, there's more interviews, there's more writing all along the way, of course, in addition to a seminary education at a seminary that's approved by the United Methodist Church. And then you go to an interview for your ordination, and the team that interviews you from the conference then recommends you for ordination. You are approved for ordination by the annual conference, but you were actually ordained by the bishop. And currently those who are ordained by Bishop Farr, which includes me, can trace our ordination chain and our lineage all the way back to John Wesley, meaning that John Wesley laid his hands on somebody to ordain them, and they ordained the next person and the next person and the next person, and we can trace that lineage to ourselves. Check this out. So it's pretty cool. Some of those people were ordained elders, and some of those people were ordained deacons. And they have two different callings. An elder is someone who is called that we traditionally see in the pastoral role within our churches, but deacons can serve in these roles as well. I'm going to clarify. An elder is called to lead churches through sacrament, word, order, and service. Sacrament meaning what we talked about. They are called to administer the sacraments of communion and holy baptism. They are called to word, meaning teaching. They are called to order, meaning the organization and leadership of the church. And they're called to service, meaning exactly what it sounds like, to selflessly serve people within the churches. And elders are a part of the itinerant process where they can be appointed to different churches across the conference by the bishop. Deacons have a slightly different call. They are not called toward sacrament in particular, but they can serve in a variety of roles, some of them inside of the church and some of them outside of the church. They typically are called to more specific ministries. Some of them are toward ministry of social justice. Some of them it can be legal. Some of them it can be music. Some of them it can be youth ministry or children's ministry. And this is what allows them to serve inside or outside of the church. They just find their role within the church on their own, as any person would when looking for a job. It just carries with it the order of deacons. That is a broad strokes explanation of that does not nearly give you the detail of all of that. But for an elder and a deacon, they are both ordained. They are both equally trained. They just have different callings. And since they have different callings, they have different roles within the conferences. Further than that, there are tons of churches across our state and across our globe that don't necessarily there are more churches than there are elders, if that makes sense. People who are willing to go through all that it takes to be able to become that. And so that means we have churches that need to be served. And oftentimes the way that we do that is in a couple of different ways. We do it through licensed local pastors, and we can also do it through certified lay ministers or certified lay speakers. A licensed local pastor goes through sort of a seminary light education that's continuous and ongoing. that they have to complete in order to become a licensed local pastor. And a licensed local pastor is placed into a particular context where their work of the sacrament and their work of teaching is approved by the United Methodist Church specifically for one church or one charge. And a certified lay minister goes through a different type of training that's not quite as intense, but a lot for a lay person to be able to be involved in. But you can have licensed local pastors and certified lay ministers in congregations of any size. It's very common to see that happen. And sometimes someone who is a second career person or exploring ministry may take the path of licensed local pastor first or certified lay minister first, as they're going through their seminary education and going through candidacy and making their way toward commissioning. Not always, but that is a route that happens. So you can have a candidate and a licensed local pastor at the same time. But once you're commissioned, you're commissioned. You're a provisional elder or a provisional deacon. So that's it. That's all there is to it. I hope that that might have cleared some things up for you. If you have more questions about our structure, if this brought up questions that might go deeper, feel free to hit me up. Here's my email. Shoot them my way. I'd be happy to discuss this and how all this fits together. Thanks so much for joining us. I hope that this brought some clarity to some questions that you maybe have, but if there's further more, let me know. I'd be happy to chat with you. Thanks so much for joining us. We hope these have been enlightening for you from beginning to end. If you made them through it all, good for you. You're a great Methodist. We'll talk to you soon.